ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयं उदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेषु भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमः नमः। ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनच्छलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकम्। वंदेहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरून्वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साकरजातं सहगणारघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णकरुणासिन्धु दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेशा गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। पंचकल्पतरुभ्यस्य कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपरिष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते राधानाथ स्वामी यदि नामिने। नमो ओम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपरिष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष निवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणी। गुरुति वाचालं पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनदारिणं परमानन्दमाधवं श्रीचैतन्यईश्वरं ॐ तत्सत्। हरे कृष्णा। सो वेलकम एवरीवन। नाइस टू बी बैक विथ यू ऑल डिस्कसिंग द श्रीमद् भागवत। दिस इज दैट वन एक्टिविटी इन कलियुगा विच इज वेरी सैटिस्फाइंग डीपली टू द सोल of all those who are nirmatsara, or to whatever extent we are nirmatsara, to that extent we find satisfaction, because this is the true relish of the soul. The soul finds true relish, true happiness, true satisfaction in hearing and discussing about the glories of the Lord and his devotees, especially when they are done in an attitude of service, appreciation, gratitude, without any actual expectation in return. Krishna has already said in the Bhagavad Gita, kathayantascha mam nityam tushyanti cha ramanti cha, that those who are the great souls, those who are the mahatmas, they actually, their favorite pastime is to discuss about me, to talk about me, to hear about me. And in that discussion, in that association, they find deep satisfaction and relish. I just came from the home of one of my godbrother and godsister, and one of my other senior godsister had also come there. So we four were discussing some Krishna Katha and sharing some realizations in Krishna consciousness. So that is so nice. It is so deeply satisfying. And now again we are continuing this. So this is the activity which will eternally give us satisfaction. And the more we progress in Krishna consciousness, we can understand our progress in Krishna consciousness by how much we are able to actually relish this activity. When the heart becomes properly purified, then one starts experiencing a deeper and deeper taste. And this activity, this very simple activity of faithfully and humbly with a proper service attitude, hearing the glories of the Lord and his devotees, is itself so powerful that by itself it is adequate to remove all inauspiciousness from the heart of the living entities, remove the influence of the modes of ignorance and the mode of passion, establish one in goodness, remove all the anarthas, hridyantasto hi bhadrani vidhunoti surutsatam. Krishna very quickly helps to dispel the darkness of ignorance. Just like when the sun rises, arka adhuna uditah, the Bhagavad says, the sun of the Bhagavat has arisen. So what happens when the sun arises? All darkness is automatically dispelled. All evil species, ghosts, goblins, everybody disappears. And the sun rises. So when the sun of Krishna rises in the form of Srimad Bhagavat in our heart, it is actually a very great blessing. And there is no greater blessing than having an attachment and taste for hearing and chanting the subject matter. Actually, that is what the greatest of the souls are always praying for. Because this is such a simple process, and this process is such that it doesn't require any material qualification. Anybody can do. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam. Is there any material qualification needed? No. Anybody and everybody can do. Educated, uneducated, man, woman, rich, poor. In all states, one can do. If nothing else, if one is deaf and dumb, he can still remember. Smaranam is still possible. That is why it is said, for bhakti, there is no actual material impediment. There is only one impediment to bhakti, and which is our false ego. It is our ego that makes us think that we are great, and it is that ego which prevents us from taking shelter of our sweet Lord, who is actually so kind and compassionate, ever willing to be merciful and kind to all of us. But out of our ego, we fail to take that shelter, and that is why we remain bereft of this wonderful blessing. So let us pray to the Lord and also his empowered representatives. Today is Ganesh's birthday, so he's also very kind. So by his blessings also, that all these inauspiciousness be removed. So today's class, we'll discuss this chapter, chapter 2.6, canto 2, chapter 6, Purush Sukta confirmed. So we will discuss this chapter. Maybe we'll spend around half an hour. And then we will also speak something about Lord Ganesh to seek his blessings also on this auspicious day. We need all the blessings we can gather in our spiritual journey. So let us try that also. The chapter today, the sixth chapter, Purush Sukta confirmed, is actually a continuation of the teachings that Brahmaji gave to Narad Muni with respect to creation. If you remember, two chapters ago, Shukadev Goswami was asked this question by Parikshit Maharaj, and Shukadev Goswami said, "Oh, rather than give my own answer, I will quote to you a conversation between Brahmaji and Narad Muni, where this topic was discussed in great detail." And then last chapter, and now in this chapter, the conversation between Brahmaji and Narad Muni is actually describing the process of creation. So Brahmaji continues in this chapter. Now this chapter again has a lot of technical details. So again, I'm going to give you a brief synopsis. I'm not going to go through the verses and describe all the various details, because practically how every element is produced, how every sense object is produced, who's the devata of every sense object, all the technical information is given. Please read that. I don't intend to go through all the details, but I will explain to you in a sense what Brahmaji is saying. So the first part, that when Brahmaji starts speaking in this chapter, he's trying to explain not just the process of creation, obviously that is one objective and that is one question, he's also trying to explain how this creation, what is its connection with the Lord? How is it connected with the Lord? So in the first few verses of this chapter, Brahmaji tries to explain how the Lord is not just totally disassociated. It is not just like, you know, you make a piece of furniture and then, you know, you go like a carpenter and there is no connection between the carpenter and the furniture other than the fact that the furniture was created by the carpenter. That is not how God creates, because sometimes, especially in other traditions, that is the kind of mentality. God created and he went back to heaven. Now he's resting in heaven nicely and, you know, we are suffering here. So it is not like that. There is a very intimate connection between the Lord and his creation. And Brahmaji begins by explaining that both the material cause as well as the efficient cause of this material world is the Lord himself. Now, what does these two terms mean? Material cause means even the elements which lead to the creation of this material world in gradually evolving variations, right from the subtlest to the grossest. All of those are also coming from the body of the Lord. When the Lord enters into each universe, if you remember, Lord Mahavishnu is lying within the Pradhan, the unmanifested matter, and then he glances on it and then he activates it. It becomes the Mahatattva, and then the false ego is manifested. We discussed some of these things briefly last time. And then eventually, all these Brahmandas, like bubbles in the sky, are created. And then the Lord enters into each of these universes as Lord Garbhodakshay Vishnu. From Garbhodakshay Vishnu's navel, the lotus appears. And within that navel, within the lotus, Brahmaji appears. And if you remember, when Brahmaji is created, actually the detailed description of what exactly happened after he got created, it's in a subsequent canto. But here he's explaining that even when he was asked to create, there was nothing. And Brahmaji is only a secondary creator. He's not the master of Maya. He cannot make something out of nothing. In fact, nobody can make something out of nothing. The Lord has unlimited energy, so from his energies he manifests. Of course, the Lord's energies are unlimited. So it is described that even all the elements as well as the senses, the sense objects, they also come from the Lord. In fact, from the Lord's subtle indriyas come the sense objects. Sense objects are known in Sanskrit as tanmatra. So, what is an example of tanmatra? Tanmatra in sense objects means taste. Taste is a tanmatra. As well as the element which can be tasted. For example, if you want to taste, not only do you need the tongue. Tongue is the gross sense organ. But you also need the sense of taste. So that is the sense itself, and that sense is controlled by a devata. Each of the senses is controlled by a devata. And then there is a tanmatra, which is the sense object. And that sense object can be, that sensation in the senses can be perceived from the sense object. The tanmatra, provided that element is there. For taste, the element required is water. Yes, that's why our mouth is always wet, right? Why the mouth is always wet? If the mouth is dry, you cannot taste anything. I don't know whether you ever thought of this, but if the mouth is totally dry, you cannot taste. So every sense actually depends on one of the elements. I'm not going to go into this in great detail. But for perceiving form, it is said the fire element has to be there. For perceiving smell, the earth element has to be there. For sound, the akasha element has to be there. For taste, the water element has to be there. And so on. For touch, the air element has to be there. This is what the scriptures say. So if you don't understand this in detail, it's okay. But all I'm trying to say is the senses are linked to the sense objects, which are linked to elements. There's a connection. And there are devatas who are in charge. All of these things are created from the gross and subtle parts of the Lord's body, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu's body. Of course, the Lord is not transformed. It is not that the Lord becomes the elements. No. From his body, these elements come. That is why it is said, this whole universe is compared like a material body of the Lord, because all these elements and substances ultimately come from their corresponding source in the Lord's spiritual body. The material world is a reflection of the spiritual world. The material bodies and senses are reflections of the spiritual senses and the spiritual body. But they are just temporary and they are jada. But one must understand that all the elements are coming from the Lord. So not only are the elements coming from the Lord, not only is the Lord the material cause of the material manifestation of the bhautik prakriti, but he's also the efficient cause. Efficient cause in simple words means that he is the agency who makes it possible. Okay, for example, if a carpenter makes a sofa, then the carpenter is the efficient cause because he brought together all these elements and made it possible. He gave that form to it. He's the efficient cause. Yes. And the trees are the material cause because the wood came from there. So the Lord is both the material cause as well as the efficient cause. Brahmaji does a little bit of assembly, but even Brahmaji's skill, knowledge, intelligence is ultimately given by the Lord only. So the Lord is there everywhere. Nothing can happen without him. Brahmaji is glorifying the Lord like this by describing this. That how the Lord is manifest within the universe in a very beautiful way. And then he makes a very interesting point. He tells Brahmaji tells Narad Muni that, Narad Muni, please remember this. Even though this whole universe is apparently endless in all directions, there are anantakoti brahmandas. Even this one brahmanda, we cannot figure out what is the extent. And there are anantakoti brahmandas which emanate from the body of the Lord in one breath, and they're absorbed again in the inhalation. Created on exhalation, annihilated on inhalation. One breath, O Lord Mahavishnu, 311 trillion years. And it appears so unlimited, so vast. But Brahmaji says, please remember, this material creation, this whole material existence is only 1/4 of the creative potency of the Lord. And what happens to the other 3/4? Where is the other 3/4? The other 3/4 is not perceivable from the material world because it is fully spiritual in nature. It is not that the spiritual world is one small corner where there are, probably 100 or 1000 saints sitting. No. 3/4 of all existence is the spiritual world. Material world is only 1/4 of the existence. Ekapada vibhuti and tripada vibhuti. Ekapada means 1/4 and tripada means the remaining 3/4. This is the terms used in scripture. Tripada vibhuti is spiritual, Brahmaji says. So I am talking only about this material world. You cannot perceive, Narada, the transcendental world. It is beyond. Humans, of course, Narad Muni can perceive because he's exalted, but he's saying about the common people. They cannot perceive. It appears that this is everything, but it is not everything. This is just a small part. This is the place where there is birth, old age, disease, death, but the Tripad Vibhuti, there is no birth, disease, old age, or death. Those who are materially attached live here, but in that world live those who are brihadvrata. Those who are totally detached from the materialistic types of enjoyments. There is no birth, old age, disease, and death there. Here everybody wants to enjoy the world for themselves, but there everybody appreciates the Lord's glories and is eternally serving him. Here the jivas want to control Maya. They think they will control, but actually Maya is controlling and beating them, but they are in illusion thinking they are the controllers. But in the spiritual world, everyone understands the greatness and the absolute control of the Lord and serve Him with pure love. This world is full of fear because of material attachment, but in the spiritual world, there is abhayam. Beautiful description. Abhaya, kshema. These qualities are present in the spiritual world. And amritam. Amritam means no death. Amrita, abhayam and kshemam. Here we are forgetful in this material world of our real identity. But in the spiritual world, there is no avidya, ignorance, but there is vidya. Everyone is fully cognizant of their spiritual nature and the transcendental nature of the soul as well as the Lord. In fact, material world, even though it has trillions and trillions and trillions of living entities, actually this number of jivas are actually small as compared to the number of jivas in the spiritual world. Because that is our home. This is like a prison. These are the living entities who have become forgetful. So there are unlimited jivas. And this is the 1/4, that is the 3/4. And in this world, to actually have a proper spiritual experience is so difficult. Very few people are able to have because they're in so much illusion. But a full experience of oneself and one's relationship with the Lord is the natural state of existence in the spiritual world. So Brahmaji explains this and says, this world that I'm describing and the creation I'm describing is for these wandering living entities who are trying to enjoy. But once the jiva acquires proper knowledge of his real nature, he becomes free from this ignorance and he can attain to the Tripada Vibhuti, which is his actual home. That is the natural environment for the soul. But ultimately, both the Ekpad Vibhuti and the Tripad Vibhuti are both finding shelter in the Lord. Then Lord Brahma goes on to explain how in his own experience he sees the Lord was the material cause of this cosmic manifestation. He says that when he himself was created and he did not know anything, and when he prayed, he was given the knowledge to perform tapa and then yajna. When he was given the knowledge to perform yajna to please the Lord, to receive his grace, to execute his duties, Brahmaji did not know from where he will get the ingredients for the yajna. Correct? Because you are just the first created living entity. There is no grocer's shop, no supermarket. Okay, I want some seeds from here, some wood from here, one pot to put a fire, some bricks. So Brahmaji says, I did not have any ingredients, but I was given the process. So I got the various ingredients from the body of the Lord. It's not described how exactly it happened, but this is what is described. He got the elements and then he performed the process of yajna as instructed by the Lord. And he achieved the proper result. And then he taught this process later. Such as, you know, the sons of Brahma, other sons, including later on to the Prajapatis, the Manus, the other sages. And they were also able to explain. Then Brahmaji says, see, this is how I have already answered. Ultimately, Narad Muni, you should understand the Lord is both the material cause and the agency. In fact, this whole material manifestation, this whole Virata Rupa of the Lord can be conceived as a form of the Lord. And that kind of conception helps gradually elevating one to a spiritual consciousness, because through that conception, one is able to always see the connection between the Lord and this material creation. See, material creation is actually very alluring and tempting, and it usually distracts the consciousness of the jiva away from the Lord, isn't it? When we say something very, you know, attractive, enjoyable in this material world, immediately we forget God and we want to enjoy that thing. That is the nature of Maya. But when we understand that this whole world is a body of the Lord, it's a form of the Lord, the trees are like hair on the body of the Lord, The mountains are like his bones. The rivers are like his veins. All these descriptions are given. Then when one sees everything, one is always able, even though he sees so many varieties, always able to connect. Oh, this is belonging to the Lord. This is the form of the Lord. So that exploitative materialistic mentality gradually goes away. One is able to see the Lord, even though externally he's seeing matter. So that is the process recommended for the neophytes. Those are not yet advanced enough to always contemplate on the spiritual form of the Lord, they should train themselves to see how everything is connected to the Lord. That is how a Krishna conscious person is. And that is why Krishna in the Gita also, in so many chapters, in the 10th chapter, 9th chapter, a little bit in the 7th chapter, he goes on giving us different ways in which we can appreciate his presence, his potency, his vibhutis, his hand, his agency behind so many arrangements, so that we can always connect and relate to him. In that way, we always see things spiritually. Yes. Just like when we see the murti of the Lord, do we think this is stone? We say, no, this is God. That is easier because the stone is carved in the form of the Lord. Yeah, it helps us. And of course, the murti is not different. When the pran pratishta is done, the murti itself is not different from God. But we are not always able to be standing in front of God. We are going around in the world doing so many things. How do we always connect? So that vision is important. That is why the Lord goes on explaining in various ways how one can see him everywhere. So this Virat Rup is another way how, when we have not yet developed so much love, how we can still see that everything, the Lord is both the material cause as well as the efficient cause. Correct? For example, okay, I'll give you an example. Let's say, a husband and wife, okay, let's say the husband goes far away somewhere and the wife is not able to interact with the husband. So even in that situation, whenever the wife sees, when she opens the wardrobe, she sees the clothes of the husband. What does she see? She doesn't see shirt, she doesn't see pant. What does she see? She sees her husband. Correct? She can even take the clothes and embrace. She will feel as if she's embracing her husband. Yes or no? Yes. Of course, this is possible in any relationship. I'm just giving this as an example. Because one is able to relate something which is connected to somebody and see that person through the medium of that particular thing. In that way, one doesn't actually see the thing, one sees the person. Yes, and that is how we want to spiritualize everything in this world. We want to see Krishna everywhere. Of course, we cannot see Krishna in the spiritual form everywhere because we are not evolved to that level of spiritual vision. But we can see Krishna everywhere by seeing how everything is connected to him, how his power is manifested to everything. Everything beautiful, Krishna says, yad yad vibhuti mat sattvam shrimat urjitam evava tatta deva avagachatvam mama tejamsha sambhavam. Wherever you see beauty, extraordinary opulence, anything wonderful, understand it is a mama teja amsha sambhavam. It is manifested from a spark of my splendor. When one sees the sun, one can remember the Lord. When one sees fire, one can remember. When one drinks water, one can remember. Krishna says, I am the taste of water. So Krishna has given us so many ways. So ultimately, all these material universes are closely connected with the Lord. They are not the Lord. The shirt and the pant is not the husband, but it is closely connected. Now the difference between the shirt and the pant and the husband, the material example, is actually the substance that makes up the cotton or the silk of the shirt and the pant is actually different from the husband. But in the Lord's case, it is not. The elements of creation itself are coming from the Lord's body. It is his energy. Mama Maya, even the Maya energy is his energy. It is depending on him. It has an intimate connection, even though it is separate from him. It is still a part and parcel of him. In that way, it is actually more intimately connected. Sorry, can you be on mute, please? Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So, the Lord is intimately connected. The materials come from here. He's the agency. And not only that, he is present across the whole material manifestation in the form of Brahma Jyoti, as well as in the form of Paramatma in the heart of every living entity. Brahmaji says, even I, as well as Lord Shiva, come from him. He is ultimately the supreme maintainer. So Narad Muni, whatever questions you have asked, I have now answered all those questions. Understand summarily that the Lord is the ultimate cause of all causes. Everything rests on him. The material world is created, maintained and sustained by him. But always remember one point. He still has his own independent spiritual existence apart from the world. It is not that God becomes the world. No. The Lord creates the world and is present in the world. The world is in him, but he's away from the world. That is the beauty. But one can see that connection of the world with the Lord and in that way become Krishna conscious and develop that connection with him. First, by seeing everything in connection with him, and second, at a more advanced level, start using everything in his service. When one understands that everything is a part and parcel of Krishna, even the soul is a part and parcel of Krishna. Mama imamsho jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatana. Mera hi amsh, Krishna says, is my part. Even the material ingredients are coming from me, my body. So ultimately everything is part and parcel of the Lord. It is not the Lord, but it is part and parcel of him. And that is why being part and parcel, it is the duty of the parts to serve the whole. So that is the basic, but yet the most deepest understanding of the tattva of the Bhagavad. That when one develops this vision, then even after being in this material world, one can actually always maintain a spiritual consciousness. Then Brahmaji says in verses 34 to 38, he goes on to say, Narad Muni, whatever I am telling you, you must believe, because I have taken full shelter of the Lord. The Lord has revealed the deepest knowledge to me. I have had full realization. And I will not go wrong because of my very, very intimate connection with him. In fact, the perfect knowledge was revealed to me at the beginning of creation. So please accept whatever I'm telling you, because this is the full truth. And understand, even though whatever I've told you is the truth, ultimately the Lord is unlimited. So nobody can actually understand him completely. Even I cannot understand him completely. What to speak of me? The Lord is so great and so unlimited. The Lord is competing with himself to understand himself completely. But he hasn't completed the syllabus yet. By the time he understands himself, he has become more than that. So the Lord himself is trying to understand himself unlimitedly. That is the amazing thing. So the Lord is so unlimited that even the unlimited Lord is continuously trying to catch up, so to say, in our material terminology, catch up with himself to develop a full appreciation and understanding of his own glories. And by the time he can catch up, he has grown beyond, because he's unlimitedly expanding in terms of his power and glory. So of course, these kind of concepts we cannot conceive with our material mind and intelligence, but we accept it because authorities like Brahma have revealed him. And that's why Brahmaji says, I have tried to understand based on whatever my little capacity is. It is perfect, whatever I have understood. But you know, I can only fill my vessel according to my capacity. But ultimately, I have to, you know, I cannot estimate the limit of his glories. Even Brahmaji, myself, Lord Shiva, cannot ascertain the limits of spiritual happiness that can be experienced in connection with the Lord. The Lord is like such a vast ocean. Each of us, according to our capacity, can drink something from that ocean of nectar. But nobody can drink the ocean. The ocean is unlimited in all directions. But one thing I know, Narad Muni, it is not necessary to drink the whole ocean. What is important is we, according to our capacity, drink that nectar and be fully satisfied. And one thing I am very clear, that perfect satisfaction can be achieved by every living entity to his most fullest satisfaction simply by glorifying the spiritual qualities of Lord Shri Krishna. This is the topmost activity. Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnoho. And that is what the Bhagavad is all about. So, then Brahmaji continues in the last few verses to describe Mahavishnu. And I think we have already discussed the topic more or less, that Mahavishnu is that original source from whom all the universes become manifest. And he is the perfect embodiment of all spiritual qualities without beginning, without end. And those who understand him properly, through the process of controlling their mind, body and senses, they can become free from all material illusion and then be free from karma and ultimately achieve his lotus feet. So none of this material world is actually the form of the Lord spiritually, but it can be likened to a body of the Lord to help us see that spiritual connection. So this is the Srishti Leela of Narad Muni, of Lord Hari, and this Srishti Leela should be understood to develop some appreciation about him. And this Srishti Leela is managed by the three Purusha avatars that I described. Mahavishnu, who is also known as Karanodakshay Vishnu. Then Lord Garbhodakshay Vishnu, who enters into each and every Brahmanda. And then Kshirodakshay Vishnu, who lies on the ocean of milk within each and every universe. So these three Vishnu, Vishnustu Trini Rupani, as the scriptures describe, are actually Purusha avatars. What does Purusha avatar mean? Those avatars of the Lord which are manifested for the purpose of managing this material world. They are spiritual, but they are manifested for the purpose of Srishti Leela. The Leela related to the creation, maintenance and annihilation of this world. But then there is another category of incarnations, O Narad Muni, that I now want to start describing. And those incarnations are known as Leela Avatar. What is Leela Avatar? Leela Avatar are those forms of the Lord who appear within this world to show his divine spiritual Leela in this world just to attract our hearts. These pastimes of the Leela Avatars are even more sweeter to hear. Yes, Srishti Leela is good and helps us develop faith and appreciation in the Lord. But those who are really fortunate develop their attachment to the sweet, beautiful pastimes of the various Leela Avataras of the Lord. And these are the Leelas that we should all try to relish. And this is how he ends this chapter 6. And then he starts discussing the various incarnations in the Leela Avatars in the next chapter. So that brings us to the end of the 6th chapter of the second canto of the Srimad Bhagavat. Grantara Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. So we have 20 more minutes. So I'm going to take the opportunity, as I mentioned earlier, to speak something about the auspicious occasion that is today. So today it is Ganesh Chaturthi. It is the, so to say, birthday of Lord Ganesh. So we will speak something in his glories. Lord Ganesh is very sweet, very attractive, very kind. He is the deity of Anugraha. He blesses. He is empowered by the Lord to bless all living entities, those who approach him, to grace them by removing obstacles in their path. So different devatas represent the different potencies of the Lord in this world. Brahmaji represents the creation potency. Shivji represents the destruction potency. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says that ultimately all these potencies are coming from me and I am only giving it. All these powers are given by me to all these various representatives of mine to execute them on my behalf. Of course, some of them are very prominent. Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma, Durga Devi, Lakshmi Devi, Saraswati Devi, Ganesh Ji, they are very, very prominent. Some of them are directly energies of the Lord or manifestations of the Lord. And some of them are empowered representatives of the Lord. They are all different parts of the Virata Rupa of the Lord, the Devatas. And all the Devatas, as such, being representatives of the Lord, being ministers in the cabinet of the universal ministry, they should be properly respected, honored, and being representatives of the Lord, they can actually bless us both materially as well as spiritually. So it is only proper that we honor them with the right understanding. So we'll speak something about Ganesh Ji. Ganesh Ji is the son of Lord Shiva and Parvati Devi. As far as his appearance is concerned, I think most of us are familiar with the pastimes. To briefly recollect, it is said Parvati Devi, when she would take a bath, oftentimes Lord Shiva, of course nowadays the husbands go out for work. Lord Shiva's main work, what is Lord Shiva's main work? Anybody knows? Lord Shiva's main work is meditation. So he will go for tapasya and dhyan sometimes for, you know, long, long periods. And Parvati would be at home and then, you know, she would be there. Then when she would be alone, then she would be sometimes bathing and other things. And then she would feel that I don't have privacy. Because Lord Shiva, even though so powerful, and Lord Parvati being ultimately a representative of Durga Devi, she owns the whole material energy. But Lord Shiva is the most detached. He barely has any home. Yes. Because those people who are experiences the greatest pleasure of the deepest spiritual connection, that's why Lord Shiva is always finding great pleasure. Because he's deeply absorbed in his deepest connection. Of course, he himself is a manifestation of that divinity. But in that manifestation, he meditates on that ultimate transcendental reality and derives great satisfaction. So anyway, when he had gone for a meditation trip, at that point, Parvati Devi at one time, she said, I need somebody to watch over this area while I am bathing so that nobody strays into this area. So it is said that she had some clay or some kind of a paste which she had rubbed on her body. She removed that paste and gave it a shape of a young boy and infused life into him. So that particular form was a very young but very effulgent and powerful boy who was Ganesha. So he was guarding that area on the instructions of his mother. And it is said that after some time, unexpectedly, Lord Shiva came back home. And when he was trying to enter that area, he was stopped by this boy And the boy said, sorry, you can't come in. I'm the guard. So, you know, nobody can come in here. And no visas are issued here until my mother comes and says somebody can enter. So he says, hey, who are you? And because that is Lord Shiva's home. So Ganesha says, no, I'm the son of Parvati, and Parvati Devi has said nobody can enter. Huh? Son of Parvati? How come I don't know Parvati as the son? So he thinks, of course, this is Leela. Lord Shiva obviously knows. But in the Leela, he says, hey, who's this naughty person who's trying to stop me, you know, giving some funny stories? So he says, get out of my way. This is my house and I can walk in. I am the husband of Parvati. But Ganesh says, no, but my mother has not made any exceptions. She did not give me any instruction that you are an exception to the rule, that you can come in. So sorry, until she comes, you have to wait. So that led to a conflict. And, you know, apparently it was a big hangama. And it is said ultimately Lord Shiva chopped off the head of this boy. By that time, Parvati Devi comes and she sees what has happened. And then she's very upset. And then she explains the situation to Shiva and complains that, you know, this is what you have done. You killed your, you know, our son. Then Lord Shiva, of course, knowing that this is all a part of his and, you know, Lord Hari's higher plan to bring about something wonderful. Finally, the matter is settled by going in, I think, I don't know whether it was northern direction, one particular direction, and looking for an animal and using the head of that animal. So it so happened that an elephant was there and they used the head of the elephant. And in that way, you know, this Ganesha now had an elephant head and a human body. And then he was blessed by all the devatas. They all blessed so that Parvati Devi is satisfied. And he was given the very important post to be Vignaharta. So this department of Vignaharta is actually a very important department, because practically in all spheres of life, ultimately we are struggling with obstacles. Something is coming in between our Riddhi and Siddhi. Yes, actually, by the way, Riddhi and Siddhi are the two wives of Ganesh. Yes. Siddhi means attaining some kind of a perfection. Riddhi means to attain success. So for success and perfection, there are so many obstacles. Ganeshji has been blessed with that potency that he can remove those obstacles and help, both materially and spiritually. In fact, even the Shastra says, even before we worship Krishna, Lord Vishnu, it is said that it is a good practice to also seek the blessings of Ganesha, so that he helps us by removing obstacles so that we can perform our service to Lord Hari properly. That is why there is this beautiful prayer. Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kurume Deva Sarvakaryeshu Sarvada. All works, remove the obstacles so that I can achieve my goal. So this is a very beautiful prayer. It's a bona fide prayer which one can use. Even devotees of the Lord, even though they're not in one sense dependent on any material arrangement or on the or on the devatas, but even then, because the Lord has empowered these devatas, the devotees also are happy to seek their blessings for their spiritual advancement. In fact, Rupa Goswami also says that it is a good idea to worship. That is why even at the entrance of various temples of Lord Krishna, Lord Vishnu, Narayan, or even other temples, you can see a murti of Lord Ganesh often at the entrance. So that before one enters, one can seek his blessings, so that one can remove any obstacles, so that one can properly connect with the deity and receive the proper blessings. In our sadhana, there are so many obstacles. in our worship of the Lord, there are so many obstacles. So that is very good. Of course, sometimes one can, you know, one can of course achieve the same effect also by remembering the spiritual master, the guru. So sometimes devotees simply remember the spiritual master. Why? Because the scripture says sarva deva mayo guruhu, that the guru, the spiritual teacher, is the sum total of all the devatas. So when one worships the guru, one actually worships all the devatas also, including Lord Ganesh. That is why when we start our class also, we say, we offer prayers to the guru. Om agyanti mirandasya jnananjana chalakaya chakshur unmilitam yena tasmai shri guru minama. This the guru has opened my eyes and given me transcendental knowledge. So Lord Ganesh also is performing the same seva. He is not only removing obstacles by actually intervening, but he is removing also the deeper obstacles which are obstructing our life by giving us proper vidya, by giving us knowledge. Ultimately, obstacles are removed not just from an external perspective. Ultimately, obstacles are inside. And obstacles are removed through the process of knowledge. And Lord Ganesh has been very instrumental actually in revealing spiritual knowledge in this world. When we went to Badrinath with many of my students, actually many of you who are in the class today came with me to Badrinath. We went all the way along the Ganga. We traveled from Haridwar all the way to Rishikesh, all the way up to through various prayas. We went to Badrinath, had very nice darshan there of Lord Badrinath and Saraswati river, and a lot of beautiful holy spots. If you remember, just within the Mana village, which is the last village on the border of India, just on the bank of the Saraswati river, we saw the Saraswati river also, there is the Vyasa Gufa and Ganesha Gufa. So many of us, we went to those gufas. We sat there. In fact, we sat in Vyasa Gufa and did discuss Bhagavat. That was the same cave in which Vyasa Dev sat and he dictated the Mahabharata, the Bhagavad Gita to Ganesha. So that cave is still there. So we all actually sat in that cave and we discussed the Bhagavat. Very beautiful place. Very nice. So it is deep high in the Himalayas, just before all the snow-capped hills. So it is said, these two caves are very next to each other. It is said when Vyasadeva wanted to compile the scriptures and especially the Mahabharata, he was thinking that, you know, I want to compose and compile. I cannot compose, compile and at the same time write. I need some expert, very intelligent and learned scribe who can take my dictation. Then he started thinking who it could be, and then he came to the conclusion nobody can be better than Ganeshji, because he's extremely sharp in his intelligence and he's very knowledgeable and he's perfect. So I said he's married to Riddhi and Siddhi. They are his two wives. So he prayed to him and Ganeshji appeared and he made that request. And Ganeshji was very happy. Wow, this is such a wonderful service that I will get to write the scriptures. But Ganeshji put a condition to Vyasadeva that you will not stop. You have to continue. You should not let my pen stop. I will go on writing. But you must not stop your dictation. If you stop your dictation, I will go. So Vyasadeva started thinking, oh, how to manage this? So he tells Ganeshji, fine, I accept your condition, but I have one condition. You will not write anything unless you first fully understand its meaning. So because of that, Ganeshji put that condition, Vyasadeva put that condition, and Ganeshji accepted that condition and said, okay, I will not write down anything unless I fully understand. So Ganeshji was with his pen and he was writing, and Vyasadeva was compiling verses after verses. Then if there would be a difficult verse, Ganeshji would pause and he would reflect on its meaning. Only when he fully understood, accepted, and digested the meaning, then he will write. So, including the Bhagavad Gita, the first person who wrote the Bhagavad Gita is Ganesh. Of course, Krishna and Arjuna had the conversation. The first person who narrated the conversation was Vyasa to the world. And it was Ganesh ji by whose grace we have this Bhagavad Gita written down. So who understands the Bhagavad Gita in this world better than him? So we can pray to him for his grace that we can also understand. Because he understood every verse perfectly, because he would not write without fully understanding and accepting every shloka. So it is said that at one point, as he was writing the scripture, at one point his pen broke. So then Ganesh was thinking, now what to do? I'm supposed to not stop my pen. So in his spirit of keeping up to his promise, because there's no other pen at hand, he broke a piece of his tusk. And he used that as a pen. I don't remember the old times they would dip it in ink and then write. So he broke his tusk, he used it, and he started continuing to write. So that was his sacrifice. That is dedication. Yes, he broke his tusk so that he could fulfill his vow and give this great scripture. So much trouble, so many have gone through so that we have the Bhagavad Gita. So we should be grateful to them. And by their blessings, we can also understand. Of course, that broken tusk of Ganeshji, there are many other stories also. There is a story where there was once a fight with Parshuram. Parshuram came there and Parshuram hit Ganeshji with an axe, the Parshu. So Ganeshji didn't want to disrespect the Parshu because the Parshu was given by Lord Shiva. So he let the Parshu hit the tusk and the tusk broke. So there are many versions of this story in many Puranas. And so some of you may ask, oh, then which one is true? Because both cannot be true. Is this true or that true? So the Acharyas explain that actually both are true. And the reason they are true is, if you remember, we discussed that the devatas appear again and again in every manvantara. So in different manvantaras, when the devatas appear, there are slightly different stories and events which happen. With respect to their birth, activities, appearance, etc. So in certain manvantaras, when Ganeshji appeared from Shiva and Parvati, the story may have happened in one way. In another manvantara, the story may have happened in another way. So all these stories are correct. It's not that they are false. But they would have happened at different points. It doesn't matter which exact manvantara the story happened this way or that way. But we respect and accept these stories as long as they are mentioned in the scriptures. We don't want anybody's, some whimsical imaginary narrations. But if it is in the scripture, they're all bona fide stories. So today is his appearance day. Yes. So he's actually such a wonderful example, Ganeshji, of knowledge. Always very peaceful, calm. Very devoted to his parents. There's another famous story how he and Kartikeya had a competition. Their agreement was who out of the both of them will get married first. And they said the competition was that he who circumambulates the whole world first and comes back to Kailash will get married first. So Kartikeya immediately left on his peacock to circumambulate the earth. Ganeshji was very not in a hurry. He just circumambulated Shiva and Parvati 7 times. And then he quoted a verse from the scriptures. It says that, he who does so, is considered to have circumambulated the whole earth. So Lord Shiva and Parvati were very pleased and he was declared as the victor. So he's very smart, he's very intelligent. And he's very well versed in the meaning of the scriptures. So, of course, there are many other points. We don't have time. It is already 10 p.m. So I'll not go into that. So just one thing, one should learn one thing from Ganesh ji. He has big ears, but a small mouth. Yeah, of course, he has a long tusk, but trunk. But big ears are very important. Big ears means one must hear more and speak less. So that is a very practical lesson for all of us. Many of us want to speak more and hear less. So one must be careful to listen to others and understand them properly, so that even in this world, we have good relationships. Everybody is eager to give their opinion. Everybody wants others to understand them, but they don't want to make an effort to understand others. So those who are actually wise, just to have knowledge is one thing. Knowledge and wisdom are two different things. We are interested in wisdom. Not just jnana, but vijnana. When we have vijnana, then actually we can achieve proper riddhi and siddhi. Just proper success and proper perfection. So let us pray to Ganesh ji that by his blessings, we can also understand the Bhagavad Gita and we can attain the end result of the Bhagavad Gita as is given by the Bhagavad Gita itself. So we pray to him again. Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kurume Deva Sarvakaryeshu Sarvada. Shri Ganesh ji ki Jai. Ganesh Chaturthi ki Jai. Okay, so thank you all very much. I'm opening the forum to any questions or comments. Anybody would like to say or add anything? Okay, so I'm assuming no questions or comments. So I saw many of you have done some special pujas to Ganesh ji also today. So that is nice if you have done. Of course, the ultimate happiness that we will give to Ganesh is when we honor his great sacrifice of writing the Bhagavad Gita, where he broke his own tusk to write. So that will actually please him more than the Modak. Modak is also nice. But the real modak that he is given to us, the real nourishment that he is given to us, is sacrifice to give us this wonderful work of Bhagavad Gita, where he has actually broken his tusk to make it available to all of us. Okay, so if there is nothing else, anybody who has joined us for the first time today? Okay, so thank you all very much. So just one thing, that coming Wednesday is the most auspicious occasion of Radhashtami, the appearance day of Srimati Radharani. So we already shared with you last time that we will devote our class on this coming Wednesday to the glories of Radharani, like we devoted our last to last Wednesday class to Lord Krishna. So in that way, please join. And please, if you want more blessings, you can also observe fasting for half a day. Janmashtami is a long fast. Radhashtami is a short fast, only up to noon. So you only have to skip your breakfast, that's all. And please remember her and pray to her. Radha and Krishna are both God. They are the mother and the father aspect of God. And the mother aspect of God is more kind than the father aspect of God. So it is a nice way to attract the Lord's mercy. So we'll discuss more about Radha Tattva, who's Radha, and some beautiful pastimes and also significance. We will do that on Wednesday. Yeah, so please be with us on Wednesday. and also worship her and pray to her. Okay, thank you all very much. Grantha Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.